What's up, everyone? My name is Michael Versbrill, and today I'm going to be talking about a new star tracker that I picked up by Move Shoot Move. Now, for those that are unfamiliar with star trackers, basically they counteract the rotation of the Earth, and this allows you to take longer exposures of the stars without having to worry about them star trailing. So you get these nice sharp stars that you can blend with your foreground and create really clean night images. Now, for a long time, I've been using this older model Ioptron, and it's worked great. I've taken some amazing photos with it, but unfortunately it has an awkward shape and it's actually pretty heavy. So it makes it less than ideal to travel with me all the time. Since my Ioptron is getting old and worn down, I decided to start looking for a new product that was smaller and lighter. And I stumbled upon the Cepho Star Tracker, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, by Move Shoot Move. And this looks to be one of the smallest trackers available at the moment. It's extremely lightweight and has a really low profile, which makes it easier to travel with me all the time. It only weighs in around 1 pound, so that's insanely light. So far I've used this tracker on 2 trips, and I'm gonna talk about the things I like about it and a few issues that I ran into when I was using it. Let me just get this guy out of the way. So the size and the weight of this tracker is amazing. You could literally carry this thing in your pocket if you needed to, so that's pretty cool. But keeping that in mind, this tracker is not meant for large, heavy telephoto lenses. So if you want to do some like deep space astrophotography, this is definitely not the tracker that you should get. This tracker is meant for wide angle and mid-range lenses like 50 millimeters. And I did try using it with my 85 millimeter lens, which worked, but it was a little challenging, and I'll explain that in further detail as this video goes on. The suggested weight limit for this tracker is 9 pounds, but that might be pushing it a little bit in my opinion. So just be cautious when putting heavy weight on this little tracker. Now, this star tracker could also be used for time lapses and panoramas, which I'm not going to get into the specifics on that in this particular video. I mainly want to focus on the star tracking capabilities. There are other videos on YouTube that I'll link in the description below, which explain in further detail about the time lapse function and the panorama functions if you're interested in those aspects of this little device. Now that I have that out of the way, I'm just going to jump into the pros and the cons of this star tracker. Now, I love the fact that it has a built-in rechargeable battery, so there's no more worrying about the power I have left in a AA battery like I had to do with my Ioptron. I simply just charge this up the night before or even in the car ride over to the location I plan on shooting, which is extremely convenient. One of my main gripes about this star tracker though is when you buy it, it is shipped from China. So this is a long wait period of 2 to 6 weeks before receiving your package. And in my case, it was even longer because USPS lost my package until I filed a report. And the good thing is, when I reached out to Move Shoot Move customer service via email, they were actually pretty quick to respond the same day to help me locate my package. So ultimately, USPS did find the package and get it to me, but that's just one concern that I had when you're dealing with something that's overseas, because it has to go through customs and all that stuff. Another issue I have with it coming from China is quality control issues. So if you receive a faulty unit and you have to return it, you have to return it all the way back to China, which means long wait times. And again, you're dealing with customs and other variables. So that's definitely something that I was kind of taking a gamble when I ordered this unit, and I was a little nervous about, but eventually it made it to me in working condition. So that's a plus. And I just want to put that out there for those that, you know, have a certain feeling about dealing with Chinese products. I get it. So just putting that out there, that's where it's coming from. Another problem that I had with this tracker was it didn't always track. So for example, after I polar aligned the tracker and I turned it on and I took a photo of the stars, they would be perfectly sharp. But then I go to take a second photo and they wouldn't be tracking. They would come out blurry. So that had me a little confused what was going on. So basically this happened sporadically throughout the night, which I thought might be a weight issue, but I used some lighter lenses that were prime lenses, and I still ran into the same issue. So then I thought maybe I had to do something with the environment. It was pretty cold that night, around 40 degrees. There was a lot of moisture in the air, so I was wondering maybe that was affecting this, the coldness and the wetness in the air. So if anybody's watching and they had a similar issue happen to them with this tracker, please leave a comment below and let me know if you figured it out, or you know, if you're just having the same issues with this particular tracker, so other people are aware of it before they buy it. So while that issue was a nuisance from time to time, it didn't stop me from taking some amazing pictures of the Milky Way, which I'll show you guys later on in this video. But first, let me show you guys how I set this thing up. All right, guys, so I'm gonna show you how I set up the star tracker. Now you might notice that I'm using a pan and tilt head instead of a ball head. Now, if you just have a ball head, that's totally fine. You could use that. I switched over to a pan and tilt head a while ago because I just love to use them for shooting panoramas, and it actually does come in quite handy when using this particular star tracker. Now, let me just take this off here. Now, one thing that's great about these particular heads is it forces you to level out your tripod, which is really important when shooting the Milky Way with a star tracker. Now, with this particular tracker, you could either mount a Arca Swiss plate or a Manfrotto plate on the bottom, or you could put it on the back side as well. Totally up to you. I prefer using it from the bottom, and just that goes in like that. Next, we're just going to add a ball head. It doesn't have to be anything special. Just make sure it could hold your equipment. Now what you want to do is have the axis of rotation of this tracker in alignment with the axis of rotation of the Earth. And to do that, you want to know what hemisphere you're in. We're in the northern hemisphere, so I want to face this at Polaris, also known as the North Star. And to help me get that in alignment, we're also going to use a laser, and that just attaches to the corner right here. Next, you just want to aim this at the North Star and use the laser to help guide that. Now, if you want more accuracy, you could actually pick up a scope from Move Shoot Move and change out your laser with that. But I still recommend using a laser just to kind of get you pointed in the right direction and getting it pretty close to Polaris, and then fine tune it with the scope. Now, the downside with the scope is there's no light, so I actually have to take my red headlamp and I'll hold it right in front of the scope, and that way I could illuminate the markings that are inside the scope, which helps me, put it onto Polaris. Now, if you're not sure exactly where to place Polaris on the scope, you could download some apps that'll help you out with that. Once everything's polar aligned and locked down, then you can place on your camera and aim it at the Milky Way or whatever you plan on tracking. Now, if you turn the dial clockwise, it should light up the N for the northern hemisphere. And if you turn the dial counterclockwise, it should do the opposite and light up the S for southern hemisphere. All right, so here we are on the computer side of things, and we're going to take a look at some of the shots I took using the Move, Shoot, Move star tracker. So let's zoom on in. All right, 1:1, stars look nice and sharp. Let's go to 3:1. Yeah, they're looking really good. I took this at ISO 2500, 24 millimeter f4 at 61 seconds, and not too shabby. This was at Assateague Island in Maryland, and I really wasn't having too many issues with it not tracking when I was using it. This is the first time using that tracker. It was when I went to Block Island, and like I said, it was a lot colder, a little more moisture in the air when I ran into those issues. So let's check out some shots from there. So this is with a 35 millimeter lens. And at 3:1, there's a little bit of trailing, not too bad. At 1:1, it's not really that noticeable. And that was ISO 3200, f2.8 at 30 seconds. This one is at 72 seconds, ISO 1600. That's starting to look nice in there. Again, got a little bit of trailing, not too bad right here, only in certain spots. I really start to push it with the 35 millimeter. It's probably one of my favorite focal lengths to use with a star tracker. This is at 145 seconds, so over 2 minutes. And that looks pretty good. Again, I got a little bit of distortion over on this left corner here. Then I went up to 191 seconds. I just wanted to go over 3 minutes. And we could see that the stars started to trail a little bit. So I think 2 minutes is probably the cutoff, 2.5 minutes. 3 minutes is kind of pushing it at 35 millimeters. Now this is one of those shots where it stopped tracking on me and I was testing out the 85 millimeter lens. And you can see it's trailing. So when I was using the 85 millimeter lens, I had a hard time tracking at this focal length. I know some people online said they used it with no problem, but I haven't really seen any shots posted by them. So I don't know if how true that is, but I finally got a decent shot with the 85 millimeter at 65 seconds, f2.2, and this was ISO 1600. And at 1:1, it's not too bad. If we pixel peep it, it looks like my focus was off a hair, but we could see some of the stars are trailing a little bit. But yeah, it was a little bit of a pain trying to get this to track at this focal length. And like I said, this is the one where it just didn't track at all. So this happened a couple times throughout the night. Going back to a wide angle lens, this is 15 millimeters, f3.5, 128 seconds, and 3:1 zoomed in. The stars look really good. Jumping back to a 35 millimeter lens. Again, this is at Block Island and stars look good. And one more we got here. 82 seconds at 20 millimeters. Yeah, so it does a decent job. I recommend probably not going over 50 millimeters. You could attempt to do 85, maybe I screwed up. It definitely could be user error because this is the second time I used it, but I think I know what I'm doing. I've used trackers for a few years now, so I'm pretty sure I had it dialed in as best as I could. I used a scope and everything, but you could try it. Maybe you have better luck, or maybe there's just some type of issue with my unit. Just keep on experimenting. If anybody has the same issue that I have and they have a fix for it, please leave it in the comment section below. And if anybody's on the fence with this tracker, I totally get it. It's coming from China. You're nervous with quality control and the ship date times and return policies and all that stuff, like I was. Some of the alternatives I was looking at was the Slick Star Tracker. This thing looks pretty compact. I think it's a little bit bigger than the Move Shoot Move, but at least you're not ordering this like overseas or anything like that. The only downside with this tracker is I think you just use like a peephole to polar align it. I don't think there's a scope or a laser attachment for this particular tracker. I know Tracy Lee uses it. There's one of her pictures right there and has some pretty good results. So that's something worth looking at as an alternative. And I was even looking at the Ioptron Sky Tracker Pro. This is their newer version, the updated version of the one that I have, where it is lighter weight and I think it has a rechargeable battery. The only downside is this huge base right here. And if you could eliminate that and maybe use this with a ball head or even like a pan and tilt head that I have, that would probably cut size and weight and just have this portion right here to worry about. It's, again, still going to be bigger than the Move, Shoot, Move, but it still might be a better alternative if you're not trying to take a huge risk ordering something from overseas. So those are some alternatives, but I'm pretty pleased with my purchase. I can't wait to take it out west, and hopefully that issue I had doesn't keep on happening, but we'll see. And if it does, I'll give you guys another update or something like that on my social media pages. So follow me on Instagram and Facebook if you want an update in the future. I'm going to California next week, and I plan on bringing that with me. So, yeah, hopefully everything works out. Thanks for watching, guys. I hope that helps with your decision-making, or maybe it made it more confusing for you, and I apologize. So take it easy. Have a good one. Bye.